What is wrong with her?
Dr. Sheena shrilled at the medical droid.
Her heart rate is slowing. Blood pressure is dropping below acceptable levels for a human being.
The droid explained. Padme groaned in the background, panting hard as she tensed for another push, but Sheena could see signs of her weakening even then. Her pallor was ashen, her voice containing more pain than strength with each verbal exertion. But why? She was perfectly healthy. I know those are the things that are happening, droid, but tell me why? How can her blood pressure be lowering like this if she is not bleeding anywhere? Her heart rate is weakening, but why? Is she poisoned? Is she sick? The Syrian doctor demanded. Bucket was holding the senator's hand, his posture betraying the utter wreck his nerves were in as he did his best to help where Sheena had positioned him. Which was, ostensibly, to help the senator give birth by holding her hand and reminding her to breathe and push. In truth, she had just placed him somewhere he would be too busy to distract her nor cause any harm.
No detectable ailments have been uncovered. Medically, the senator appears completely healthy.
The droid reported.
That's what I just intimated! I demand you provide a theoretical diagnosis this instant! Compute!
She ordered. The 2-1B series droid before her paused and made a clicking sound as its cavernous processor went to work, leaving Sheena sitting and waiting in her hover chair, tapping her good foot impatiently. Behind them, being attended by several other droids, was the dying form of Padme Amidala, who had begun weakening the instant she went into labor. The droids were urging for a C-section procedure to save the babies, but Sheena was utterly unconvinced. The senator from Naboo had been just fine minutes ago, and they were in the heart of the senatorial medical facility, one of the best of its kind in the entire galaxy. Even if she went over and cut off Padme's head with a Sith-forsaken lightsaber, the facility here should have been sufficient to not only save her brain, but provide her with a near full body prosthesis in a matter of hours or days. So how, by the many moons of Iago, were they losing her? The droid finished its calculations and began to respond.
A proper theoretical diagnosis is not possible at the moment, due to lack of data.
The medical machine droned.
That is literally impossible. Are you malfunctioning? What about family history, genetic disease, prions?
Sheena listed off.
Negative. No detrimental proteins have been found within any of her samples or scans. And her family history is impeccably clean. Readings of her genome reveal no abnormalities present in any capacity.
The droid informed.
Then her mate's medical history. Maybe he passed something on to her. A condition or aberration born of misaligned genetics. Is he near human? What race is he?
Sheena asked, racking her mind for any answer that might explain Padme's degrading state.
We do not have access to those records. Senator Amidala has opted to keep the father of her children confidential. Without her compliance, it is not possible for us to determine.
It began to say.
Are you joking? We have her damned children and the entire Republic medical database. Sample their DNA through a Metreon scan and begin matching the results to the existing samples in the archive. Tell me who the father is so we can start piecing this together.
The irate doctor demanded.
We cannot. We do not have the authority to.
It started again. Sheena threw her datapad at the droid, smacking it with a loud tink on its metallic skull, eyes glaring.
I have the authority! I am a member of the Chancellorship's doctoral staff. By the power of the Chancellor's office, I negate her right to privacy as of right now. Begin the medical scan at once!
She yelled. The droid seemed to pause to compute this as well before nodding and deploying the scan. Sheena sourced as much of the medical information as she could into her chair terminal, sorting through the data as it came up. The first result was among the most shocking. Midichlorians. The children were Force-sensitive, and extremely so. As interesting as that was, it barely prepared her for the full findings of the scan.
What the... Anakin Skywalker is the father?
She breathed, exasperated.
Great. Just great. That doesn't complicate matters at all. Give me a full breakdown of his medical history, both him and his family, if we have any records of them at all. Karking Jedi, always so sloppy.
She fumed, helping the droid check through the data, looking for a pattern of any kind. But there was simply nothing there. Nor should there be. Anakin was human, and exceptionally healthy in and of himself. Nothing in what she was seeing would suggest that any complications analogous to what Padme was suffering through should occur.
There are no markers or signs that would result in this kind of vital failing. Even after reviewing the entirety of Supreme Commander Skywalker's medical entries, her body does not appear to be under attack. Nor is this the result of an autoimmune response. It is as though she has lost the will to live.
The droid barely had time to start its final sentence before Sheena jammed a button on her armrest, deploying a thin, glassy barrel from the base of her chair and firing a single shot from it. The weapon issued forth a loud, silver flash, a discharge from a gun far more exotic than any blaster. And the droid was torn to pieces as the projectile ripped a massive rent into the center of its chest cavity. The machine stumbled and tumbled about before falling into a sparking heap upon the ground.
Lost the will to live? What kind of nonsense are they programming into medical droids these days?
She grumbled, ignoring the shocked teams of droids and other medical personnel around her as she assumed control over the primary medical console, taking Padme's treatment into her own hands. She knew that there must be something she was missing, something hidden from her. Sheena's eyes seemed to vibrate as she began to absorb data on the primary console, scanning medical reports and blood test screens as quickly as her impressive mind could process. The damned droid appeared to have been correct about at least one thing. Nothing was pointing to the reality they were watching. Nothing. Padme was fighting for her life, for her children's, for her Jedi lover, for the Republic itself. But something was killing her. A pressure that none of them could see, a force which was gradually squeezing and sapping the life out of her body. But what could it be? What could it be? The answer struck her like a bitter upchuck of bile. She enforced upon herself the deductive mantra that had served her so well in the past. Once all other possibilities have been eliminated, then all which remained must be the answer, no matter how unlikely. Any mystery could be narrowed or destroyed by the application of that creed. She had to believe that, for it was only through it that she could muster the will to subdue her pride and make the call she needed to make.
Get me in contact with the Jedi Temple,
she sighed, looking to the nearest droid who was not otherwise occupied. What? The Jedi? What can they do about this? Bucket asked from Padme's side.
Whatever is killing her is not a normal ailment, Bucket. She is dying out of nowhere, as if by magic. So if we are dealing with magic and not science, then we need a wizard,
Dr. Sheena said, tapping furiously, injecting the senator with a dose of adrenaline to keep her alive long enough for the help she would need to arrive. So, you mean a Jedi? Bucket asked, flinching as Padme squeezed his hand twice as hard as before. Dr. Sheena shook her head.
Not just any Jedi,
she said, before turning back to the droid, who was already hurriedly typing on a communications terminal.
We need Master Yoda, and we need him now!
Boba hung off the end of the speeding bike, facing with his back to the driver, the seat he was in being designed for a much larger rider. Sand billowed about the two of them, and the bright suns colored them in, blinding any unshielded eye. They were on the way to Arnthot's lookout, a survey and monitoring station a few clicks out from Arnthot's pass. It was, officially speaking, a local project which was funded by the Republic. However, that funding had dried up ages ago, along with any interest in the actual project itself. Yet still, the station remained staffed with at least 15 crew all throughout the year, for years since that time. Why? One word could explain it. Spice. The scientists had been replaced with less technical professionals of a distinctly less civilized profession. Yet due to the excellent positioning of the station and the dry, difficult conditions around its approach, business tended towards being good, and the project, such as it was, remained successful. Currently, the entire thing was owned by Jabba the Hutt, who mostly used it as a taxing station, enabling runners from nearly any organization to utilize it, provided they were not stingy with their credits when passing through. Oddly enough, the Commissar and his people had seemed more interested in its original, failed purpose than its current enterprising one, and upon learning about it, had dispatched Boba out on his first official job as an agent of the Imperium. He was to help these strangers locate and secure the station ahead of their main body's movement into the pass itself, a route they were taking while searching for where to found their new capital. Speed was an important factor, as their supply seemed to be severely limited. So he had been sent with a squad of Space Marines to facilitate both the capture and technical appraisal of the equipment. These Marines, however, were not the same kind he had seen before. Those giants had been taller, wearing green armor, and had kept their enclosed helmets on at all times. The new warriors he rode with wore gray armor, which they covered in bone charms and massive beast pelts. They wore no helmets, not a single one, allowing long, greasy strands of braided hair to blow in the wind. Each man sporting a mane, but no man wearing it in the same fashion as the last. Four were on foot, three were on a pair of bikes, and the last rode a beast, a monster resembling, in the most basic of ways, a wolf, though it was clearly something more. The two drivers of the bikes, and the four men who ran after them, seemed relatively young to Boba, though still older than himself. They wore feral grins and were prone to spontaneous singing and howling, something he'd learned all too well during their three-hour exodus towards the station. Their armors were relatively unadorned, at least compared to the last two in their party, both of whom bore armors which were thick with tribal vestments and tokens of bone, steel, and flesh. One of them rode nearly as Boba did, facing forward on the second bike. He stood apart from all the others, his armor appearing black and red, with only one shoulder pad on his right side matching the others, bearing an orange field with the shadow of a wolf's growling head imprinted darkly over it. Though he wore bone charms and pelts of his own, his armor stood out more for the pair of massive industrial droid limbs which protruded from the back. His face was wizened, scarred, and he wore a thick black beard to match his greasy, braided strands of dark hair. The last among them, who was first in truth, was a man who seemed not so much apart from the rest of his pack, but an extreme example of what and who they were. He seemed even larger and broader than the rest, his armor far more ornate, rattling with its accolades and charms. He bore an axe which shimmered like storm lightning over reflective ice, a weapon he held perpetually in his hand as he rode astride the powerful wolf beast which was his mount. His hair was white and shaved on one side, revealing a deep, blue-woad tattoo which was woven into an intricate, nodding pattern. He wore scars under his eyes and across his chin, the irregularity and asymmetry of them suggesting that they were not intentional additions to his face. And his eyes were bright yellow and intense as the twin suns of Tatooine. Boba did not know the names of the warriors, but he knew that this leading one was called a Wolf Lord, and he was warned to maintain a proper level of respect when dealing with him and his pack. They remained at relative pace with each other, the four on foot sprinting fast enough to keep up with those who were mounted, at least until they came within 4 kilometers of the station in question. "It's not far now. Turn south a bit, and you'll see it soon on the sunward horizon," Boba transmitted into their squad comm.
"Aye, then it's time,"
said the man at the lead, the one riding the beast.
"We make it quick. Any who damage the structures will make penance to me, and I have no reason to be kind to reckless claws. Remember yourselves, and the Wolf Father's wisdom. Bring back from this hunt a victory to humble our cousins. Break your shackles and let howl thine fury, my claws of winter!"
At those words, the following men released sudden and terrible howls. Bellowing through augmented throats, their shouts shaking the sands for miles around, before their voices were joined by the sudden roar of their bike engines. The blocky machines lurched forward so quickly that the young Fett nearly found himself thrown clear of his bouncing seat, barely managing to keep his hold as troughs of sand were kicked up several meters into the air.
"Whoa! Hey, a little warning maybe?"
Boba yelled, but the man at the head of the bike only bellowed out a laugh in response to his whinging.
"Don't ye blink, whelp, or you'll miss a sight you're not likely to see again. This is the charge of the Vulcan Fenrika. Enjoy it!"
The man yelled, his bike and his compatriot quickly outdistancing the running marines. Even as the wheeled machines themselves were outdistanced by the lopping, leaping footsteps of the beast their leader rode. They sped like bullets over the sand, the odd spinning tracks of their vehicles doing as well as the speeders when it came to acceleration, even though the ride was not even half as smooth.
"There!"
Boba yelled, pointing towards the thin silhouette of several buildings in the distance, hand gesturing at what was rapidly revealed to be 4 clustered, rounded structures. The riders honed in on them, their leader arriving and dismounting before any of the others managed to reach the camp. Throwing himself from his saddle and taking the lead, his beast padding alongside him. He was there for nearly 30 seconds before the others caught up, Vikes veering sideways to arrest their momentum, riders holding the handlebars of their vehicles with one hand, presenting thick, stocky slug throwers with the other. Boba was shocked when the bikes pulled up to the scene, blinking inside his enclosed helmet as he absorbed all there was to see. The outpost was in ruin, bodies strewn across the steps and general area. Fett rapidly counting 10 of the 15 suspected inhabitants dead on the ground from his initial vantage point alone. Standing amid them, looking around slowly from side to side, was the leader of the wolves, axe born and half-raised. But he did not look pleased. There was a pause that lasted a couple seconds as they all looked about, the larger marine stalking over several bodies before looking back towards the bikes, his face lined with a scowl.
"Master, what sense do you have of this?"
asked the marine who drove Boba's bike, placing a foot down but not dismounting. It took Boba a few seconds to see it all as well. The fact that none of this carnage was the marine's own handiwork. He had come upon them like this, just as they had, and Boba felt his hidden face burn just a bit. Of course they had found them like this. As though it were possible for anyone to kill this many people that quickly. Shaking his head, Fett swung himself off the vehicle and began to look around.
"Dismount and spread out, Swift Claws. Find me some clues as to what happened here. Who did this? Iron Priest, locate the main building here and begin your work,"
said the Wolf Lord. The bike-mounted marines nodded and did as instructed, stepping into the space of the four buildings, weapons drawn, while the black-armored man among them stomped out between the structures and then marched into the nearest one. Meanwhile, the bounty hunter continued his examination. "Ah, so that's what happened," Boba said a second later as he kneeled by one of the fallen corpses, tracing his gloved hands along the man's chest and then to a line of damage on the building wall nearby.
"What?"
asked the Wolf Lord, turning to regard their local guide. Boba stood and pointed down at the pockmarks lining the wall, and then at one of the dead spice runners, a Nikto whose face had been completely caved in by something blunt and pointed. None of this damage was made with blasters. Slug throwers and melee weapons. Looks Tusken to me. Must have been a raid. Recently, too. No one started to smell yet," said the Fett, scrunching up his nose.
"Ha! A matter of opinion, lad. But he speaks truly, Wolf Lord. Stink as they do, these aliens have not yet begun to putrefy, provided such beasts are made with the logic to rot at all, that is,"
said one of the Swift Claws who knelt nearby, over a pile of three men who had come out of one of the buildings, their small heap suggesting they had been shot one after another as they exited. The towering Master of the Marines raised a thick eyebrow.
"Tuskens, are they Xenos?"
asked the Wolf Lord. Boba nodded and stepped away from where he had been examining the bodies, swinging his head around. "Yeah, locals. The real locals. Technically that makes us the aliens, but they're not human. They don't play nice with outsiders. Kinda want everyone to get off their planet. The ones who did this can't be too far away." "Huh. It's just strange," he said, looking about the camp and then between two of the buildings.
"What is?"
asked the axe-bearing Astartes. "Well, Tusken raiders raid, obviously. But how did they manage to pull this off? They shouldn't have speeders of their own, and sneaking up on this outpost in the middle of broad daylight, even with speeders, would be a trick I don't think they could pull off. Not unless..." Boba muttered, walking about.
"By the Wolf Father, spit it out, whelp!"
said the Swift Claw. Yeah, give me a carking second," Boba said, waving his hand at the demanding marine as he looked around. "Ha, there," he said, spotting a set of wide, odd indents in the sand. The two marines closest to him, the Wolf Lord included, stepped towards what he was examining and looked at the patterns. The younger one scoffed.
"Aye, seems to me you found it, whelp. That sand, all right, explains it all,"
he said with a laugh. Boba scowled under his helmet.
"It ain't the sand he's looking at. What's sat here, boy? What do these lines mean?"
asked the Lord. Fett nodded at this. "From the size of it, I'd say it was a spice train. Jabba probably sent it ahead of you, maybe even sent it to get ahead of you around the route. Either way, it was stopped over at the station, parked right here when the attack began. And now it's gone. It would have been distracting while it was present, maybe distracting enough to hide a rapid approach. But again," Boba said.
"Tuskens don't use speeders,"
the Wolf Lord said with a nod. Boba nodded back. "Not usually," he affirmed. The other marines were arriving on foot now, approaching from all sides and taking up a perimeter. It was at that moment that the black-armored Iron Priest emerged from the building he had been within.
"Report,"
said the Wolf Lord.
"Aye, it's not good. The machinery is fetid and weak as it is, but the damned Xenos made off with several key components. Recently removed. I have no inkling of what they intend for them, but I know that it will not be easy to replace them, nor possible to achieve our goals without them,"
the four-limbed man explained. "That doesn't sound right either. Tuskens don't care about machines, or even spice. They raid for food, water, and basic materials like metal and ceramics. What would they want with a survey outpost? Said Boba Fett.
That's not all either. I found a survivor, but he won't last long. He was holed up in the backmost room, 4 guns aimed at the door. I took him from him, but his wounds were already severe. He's some kind of Xenos, but he looks mannish, is saying things, but I have no clue what.
The Iron Priest informed.
Right. Fett, get in there and find out what you can. Yannick, cover the guide. His safety is your safety.
Said the Wolf Lord. Aye, it'll be so, Lord. Said the driver of Boba's bike, shadowing the bounty hunter as Fett nodded and drew his 2 blaster pistols, walking cautiously into the building the black armored priest had emerged from. It was not large inside, with a relatively low hanging ceiling and most of the natural space being taken up by the dusty machinery within. The building had apparently been used for storage by the spice runners, as canisters and crates lay scattered and smashed about, recently looted by the raiders. Thanks to this, Boba and his 7-foot-tall shadow were able to locate the backmost room quickly. Peeking inside, Boba found that the Iron Priest had spoken true. Laying there, against the backmost wall, was a man, a spice runner with 4 arms. Boba did not recognize the species right off the bat, though, save for his extra limbs and a sort of feral scruffiness which was not unlike that of the space wolves that accompanied the bounty hunter, the man seemed human. He glared at Boba, 2 of his hands on either side crushed and useless, the others empty, disarmed.
And what's that now? Another giant?
The man coughed.
Stay here.
Boba said to Yannick, and though the Astartes did not nod or otherwise affirm the order, he did as instructed, allowing Boba to enter the room alone, though he remained crouched by the door. I'm one of Jabba's bounty hunters, said Boba, turning the corner and raising his blaster pistols up, but not sheathing them. Came to check in with the station. Boba lied as he drew closer. The man flashed Fett a bloody grimace and spat.
No use lying to a dying man, he growled.
It was then that Boba saw the hole burnt straight through his chest and knew that the man spoke true. Not lying, not exactly, Boba said as he came to kneel beside the spice runner.
What the hell happened?
He asked a moment later.
Carking Tuskens!
The man groaned, blood dribbling down from his lips to his chin.
Never saw them. Sandstorm kicked up and we never saw them. So fast. It all happened so fast. I just came here for a drink. Something to wet my tongue before the train continued on. Heard fighting. Got my guns out. Got ready for him. Killed a few. Till their leader came in. So fast.
The man said.
You got me good. Stumbled in here, trying to make a stand of it. But he didn't follow me in. Wasn't after me. I heard the train take off, and then everything got quiet. I was waiting to die, or to fight, or to die fighting. But it was quiet till the howling. And then the sound of machines. Then a giant came in here. Shot him, but my blasters didn't do nothing to him. He crushed my hands, took my weapons, and now you're here. That's what happened.
He finished. Boba nodded. Any idea why they hit you? Why they removed part of the machines here? The fanged man shook his head.
No, I figured they were just after the fucking train. The spice, maybe. Damn! Shouldn't have brought family into this. My daughter's still on the damn train. I hope they got clear. Oh.
He mumbled. Hey, stay with me, Boba said as he watched the man's eyes flutter. This injury, it doesn't look like a gaffing stick or even a blaster wound. How did you get it? What did this to you? Boba asked. The man looked up at him and smiled grimly.
It was a Tusken,
he said, expending a breath which he did not draw back in. Hey, stay with me. We can get them back for this. Just stay with me, Boba said, but the man was already gone. The bounty hunter emerged from the building with Yannick a few moments later. Grimacing under his helmet, the Wolf Lord was waiting.
Report,
he said the instant the two touched sunlight. The Tuskens attacked during a sandstorm. It's possible they are after the train. They are organized, and they have a capable leader who managed to facilitate this raid. It seems likely that they took off after the train, if they have not hijacked it themselves, said Boba. The Wolf Lord nodded curtly, and then swung around to address the other Marines.
Iron Father, we'll return soon. Do what you can with what you have and prepare this station for repairs and function. Bloodclaws, secure the outpost. Swiftclaws, mount up,
said their leader.
You as well, Fett. We're chasing after that train,
he added. All right, but I've got no idea how you're going to track it. Those spice trains can cruise at incredibly high speeds and leave little to no trail behind them once they get going, Boba said as he followed Yannick to the back of the bikes.
Leave that to Lenvrick,
the Lord said, patting the side of his massive beast's neck before tossing himself up into his saddle. Boba climbed back onto the back of the bike and watched as the wolf-like monster padded over to the trails in the sand and began to sniff the indents. By the way, Wolf Lord, the bounty hunter added hesitantly.
Hmm?
Was the response he got. You're going to want to be very careful on this one. The Tusken leader... I don't think he's a normal Tusken at all, said Fett.
And why is that?
Asked the Lord of the Marines. Because the wound that killed the Spice Runner didn't come from a Tusken weapon, nor did it come from a blaster either.
Oh? Then what do you figure killed him?
Asked the huge Astartes, rearing in the saddle as the mount picked up its head and pointed its snout into the distance. There's only one weapon I know that makes wounds like that, said Boba, grabbing on tight as the bike beneath him began to rumble. It looks to me like he was killed by a lightsaber. They had been forced out into the wide open spaces by threat and terror of death and worse. They ran, skins flayed by winds which burned too hot and moved too fast, shearing their faces with shifting sands. And behind them, the demons gave chase. All red and dark and terrible, on legs born of unnatural power, each terrible step taken by each horrible beast, thrumming and thumping the grains beneath their feet. Pau'an's screams filled the day within the night. 100 setting suns burning to the heart of their planet. Their voices joined to the world's own shriek. Utapau was dying. They were killing them. They had thought, he had thought, that they were safe. So few ships and their shields dotted their world, confounding the initial weapon of the enemy. Ron-On knew this because he had seen it, had watched from his monitoring station in the great sinkhole city of Mar Talon as they came and fired and failed with their attack. But that terrible red and black thing in the sky came for them not once, but twice. It and the ships it brought devoured their defense fleet, using tactics and weapons which defied sense itself. Like the cloak of death or the chain of time, it arrived once more, inevitable. And now it hung above them, a horrible, bladed thing, beating into their world's skin. A terrible, hateful beast whose hungering, molten spit and crimson glare sought the unwanted factories far below the surface. And also, from that red and black monstrosity had come the demons, falling like fell fruit, screaming across the skies in pods which killed and crushed and blew apart. And then the screams came. Oh, the screams. The ancients had never wanted to be a part of this, to become subject to the Confederacy in this way. But never in Ronan's wildest, most terrifying nightmares had he conceived that they would be punished in such a way. His face was burnt, more ashen than ashes. But still, he and the others ran on, fleeing from the rim of the now burning, shrieking city that had been their home. Horrible weapons still fell from the sky, exciting the wind to become even crueler than it naturally was. But still, even into its blades they ran. And turning behind him, he saw that death still followed, red and tall and terrible. His team around him, he ran, arms out as though he could, by his will, carry them with him. But they were short, and he was tall. And though the wind cut at him, it sliced them even more, their biology innately subterranean. They looked to him, silently pleading for guidance, but he could do nothing but die with them. And to his shame, he was not prepared to do even that much. His long legs took him past them in just a few strides, and they cried out, but were abandoned. Their Utane voices shrill before being brutally silenced. The beasts showed no mercy to any they found, but seemed to take a perverse joy in the way they silenced the terrified squeals of the workers. A great guilt rose to consume Ron-On, but the sheer fear which coursed through him was an even larger beast, and consumed the guilt in turn. Suddenly, he noticed that around him, though he did not know when or from where, he and his had been joined by countless other survivors. Utapauans of all kinds and ages fleeing in his same direction. They howled as the wind slapped them, and the demons brought them down, moving as a great, terrified herd. Some carried weapons, and some among those weapon-bearers gathered enough courage to turn and face their pursuers. Not a one lasted long, but the Utai died first. And soon, there were only his people left, and even then, their numbers were thinning with alarming speed. Ron-On could see it from the corners of his eyes, the crowds around him, within his peripheral vision, vanishing. Those who remained were driven on like panicked cattle, running for what felt like hours in the brilliant night, leaving their city far behind. The sun began to rise, but it was rising in the wrong direction, directly in front of them. Ron-On dove to the ground, shielding his head, but when the blast wave came, the waking world was taken from him. When next he returned to it, it was by way of a caustic chemical smell, a crushing pressure over most of his body, and the sound of an all too familiar scream. He gasped, but only softly, his chest compressed to allow nothing greater, and he blinked, his eyes stinging with blood and sweat and droplets of whatever that foul-smelling liquid was. He took a moment to recognize that it was daytime, true daytime. He was still out on the flatlands, but his body was protected from the now calmer winds by way of the many bodies which lay atop him. He was half buried in a pile, a mound-like stack of the dead, mostly composed of other Pau'ans. Being several centuries old, he had just enough wisdom to stifle his reaction, looking about carefully and thanking his warding stars that he had. The Pau'an was surrounded by several other such piles of the dead, and through, over, and between them, he saw the demons stalking about, their skins of steel red as blood, grinding and whining in the sandy corpse wind of his world. He wisely chose to play dead, and by that was not noticed by the nearest mechanical-seeming monster, its eye lenses burning red from within suits of what nearly seemed like knightly armor. He eyed them as stealthily as he could manage, scanning about without moving, and then widening those searching eyes when he suddenly caught sight of their leader, a feature he recognized by the being's bearing alone. It was among a group of five other demons, each one larger and denser than the others he had seen, all of them squatting and sitting atop the absolute largest of the corpse mounds, with their king beast sitting nearest the pinnacle in the center. They had removed their red-eyed helmets, revealing their underflesh to be disturbingly near human, but with distinct differences that told Ron that they must be anything but. Their features were too large, too broad, and their teeth. All of those who sat atop the mound had sharpened teeth, teeth which fit together perfectly, teeth they were using. Another scream, so much like the one which had woken him, but coming from a different throat. The scream of Pau'an flesh, the scream of elders and ancients. There was a short line of his people before the mound, chained by heavy shackles, guarded by other monsters who bore burning swords or mechanical claws. The line forced to move, step by step, forwards towards the mound. Ron'an watched as a 700-year-old matriarch was dragged forward by her arms, now at the head of the terrible line. She screamed again, but it did not even slow them. As with the Pau'an who had come before her, her arms were not unshackled, but rather sliced off at the wrists, the remnants of her hands and arms callously shaken off the chains. The woman herself was yanked forward by the tatters of her clothes, her voice raw with an agony Ron'an had never been exposed to before. Over her screams, he saw the monster at the top of the mound indicating towards her, extending a large, finger-mounted talon, and then gesturing at one of his own beasts, a red warrior who stood at the base of the mound. It nodded and stepped forward towards the elder Pau'an, who was going pale, going into shock as the stumps of her arms bled her severely. But before she could die, the demon removed its helmet, grabbing her by the throat and lifting her. It opened its maw, the ring of shark-like teeth which it bore spreading open wide, and then settling around her skull. The cracking crunch which followed was an even more horrifying sound than that of her screams before. It was only at that point that Ron'an realized for certain that the monsters on the hill of corpses were eating. They and their leader, and one by one, the underlings beneath them, were devouring his people. Those chained and dragged forward were captured like the cattle of an enemy city, each being butchered and consumed by the conquerors. They were eaten head first, though clearly that was not all. Not for some. While a few of the demons ate only the head, or just the top of the skull, several continued, and even now, those upon the mound held arms, legs, and ribs, chewing and biting into their flesh like the extinct predatory beasts which once roamed their world. The scene continued and repeated for some time, and Ron'an was fixated upon it. Trapped within a terror which was too much to observe, yet too horrible not to. By the time he could pull his eyes away from the living feast that was being made out of his race, it was nearly too late to prevent his own fate. At last, the nature of the foul-smelling chemical was revealed to him. As he saw another, smaller mound of corpses being doused in it by one of the smaller demons. And then, it was lit aflame. The fire spread unthinkably fast, linking from one mound to the next. It was a flammable liquid, one of such intensity and potency that it seemed to almost liquefy the bodies it touched in mere seconds, charring and burning them away. And the lines of the flames were making their way around to each of the piles of the dead, his own included. The thought of such a death drove a wild fear into the heart of the Pau'an. And he kicked and pushed suddenly, trying to work himself free of the pile. Others who had done as he had began to let loose their death screams, voices and bodies emulating to the amusement of the demons which lit the pyres. But Ron-On had stopped paying attention. His only concern was escape. Yet his body was riddled with weakness, and he was sure that many of his bones were broken. Even so, the pile was slick with blood and worse, and he used this to extricate himself, throwing his body, which was coated in the flame-catching liquid, aside from the death mound mere moments before it too came alive with fire. He hit the ground on his hands and knees and began to crawl, began to try to hide the heat from the pyres all around him, scorching his skin and nearly lighting him ablaze. His mad shuffling made him precious little progress. A massive metallic hand reaching down to grasp his shirt, ripping him from the mud and gore which coated the ground, and up, his flailing resistance doing nothing more than providing further sadistic entertainment for the demons. He was brought trembling to the foot of the only mound which did not burn, the mound the King Monster and his entourage sat upon. That beast, that demon from the red skies, glared down upon him and grinned, his mouth dripping with the ichor and cerebral fluids of Ron-On's own kind. It was framed in flames and bodies and blood, a master of carnage atop his fitting throne. He gestured down towards Ron-On with one of his terrible, clawed hands, eyes flickering in the light of the flames. And as Ron-On felt himself being lifted, as he felt the gust of hot breath roll over the back of his bald head, felt the initial pinpricks of those terrible, enormous teeth beginning to dig into the crown of his skull, his last, all-consuming thoughts were of fire, of that terrible vision which was to be his last, of his people being butchered and burning, and the entire galaxy roasting with them.
Finally!
Sheena exclaimed as the doors into the facility opened and a small green figure hovered in on a diminutive floating chair. Master Yoda sat serene, but obviously troubled atop his floating contraption, having it land nearby and dismounting, walking to the side of the bed. Padme was looking faint. She was on the very cusp now. Even so, her eyes seemed to clear from her agony for a few precious moments as Yoda reached up with one of his wizened three-fingered hands and took her limp limb from Bucket, who stood nearly as listless as the senator as they watched her die.
Master Yoda,
she gasped weakly.
At peace be now. Arrived I have, at the request of your doctor. If aid I can render, it will be yours,
he said to her. She smiled wanly before closing her eyes again, her breathing shallow. Yoda turned then to face the impatient Dr. Sheena, ambling over to her, supported on his cane.
Not long, it will be, before one with the Force she becomes. Ease her passing, I will.
Ease her passing? You mean let her die? I don't think so, said Dr. Sheena.
Do more I cannot, limited are my healing arts. And not our way it is to defy the natural cycles of life and death. He said solemnly.
Then I guess today is our lucky day,
she snapped.
There is absolutely nothing natural about what is happening to her right now,
Sheena said. Yoda seemed to perk up a little at that, his attention honing in. And by that, what mean you? He asked.
I mean exactly what I said. The Senator is perfectly medically healthy. But she is dying. You need to help me stop that from happening, or we won't just lose her, but her two children as well,
said Dr. Sheena. Poison, then? With such matters, limited my abilities are.
It's not poison. It's the Force. It has to be. She is being killed by something metaphysical, something our sensors and tools cannot detect or prevent. None of this makes any scientific sense. The only way I can explain it is with an unscientific conclusion. Someone, somewhere, probably a powerful Force user, is killing her. I won't pretend to understand your esoteric ways, because I don't and can't. All I know is what this is not, and it's not something that can be stopped by droids or medicine,
said Dr. Sheena. Yoda paused to ponder that, rubbing his chin. If true, then powerful this technique would have to be. At great cost in focus and strength would such a murder come. Such a thing only the Sith could perform, said the Master. But why? He added.
Why? Why? Why does that matter? Sheena shouted, throwing her hands up. You want a reason why? Fine, I'll give you one. Do you have any idea who the father of these children are?
The doctor railed.
Dr. Sheena, don't...
Padme gasped.
You be quiet! I'll give you a say in all this when you stop dying!
Sheena shot back. Looking back at the small green Jedi, she could see she had his rapt attention.
She is the mother of Anakin Skywalker's children! You know, the rising star of your order, the hero of the Grand Army of the Republic, the man we just made Supreme Commander a few hours ago?
She said.
What better way for Dooku and the Confederacy to hurt us than by hurting him through her death? I can't understand all the involved motivations, but do you really think that Anakin will handle this loss well? Especially when we are on the cusp of a new, greater war! If this can only be done by a Sith, then it makes perfect sense as to why Dooku would be doing it! Padme Amidala is the head of the Loyalist Committee. She is one of the great powers in the Senate. Killing her will destabilize everything, so hurry up and save her! I don't care what mumbo-jumbo magic you need to use to do it. Just get whatever it is that is killing her to stop, and I'll handle the rest,
she said. Yoda looked stunned for a moment, but then his face hardened, as within his mind, many disparate pieces began to come together. The Chosen One, the Jedi, the Sith, great fear, great love, and at the center of it all, Padme Amidala and her two children. Yoda nodded, for now he knew what he had to do.
Time for an intercession there is not, he said, ambling back over to Padme's side. Too progressed the technique is, and too unfamiliar with it am I, he added.
So, what? Thoughts and prayers? Is that all you can offer right now?
Sheena asked, sounding disgusted. Yoda shook his head.
Draining her it is. Taking life till death is present, he said, gesturing with a hand and sliding over a set of stepping stairs from a nearby closet.
It opened up as it came to rest by her bed, and he used it to climb up so he could look over the pale senator, extending his hands over her and closing his eyes.
To be fought, to be resisted, such things give the dark side its power. But play by its rules, I will not. What we lack in strength, make up for, shall I? With wisdom, give to it what it desires, I must. And then, take back what I have given, I shall,
he said.
Damn it! This is no time for your fanciful turns of phrase!
Sheena started to say.
Shh!
Yoda hissed, hushing her. The room seemed to take the cue, and a silence filled the air as all eyes lingered over the Jedi. Even Dr. Sheena, who was glancing between him and Padme's faltering vitals. There was a sudden tension in the air, a soft, unhearable hum which began to quietly fill the space. Yoda's face, eyes closed, seemed to tighten, his fingers tensing, but his hands remaining open. The lights flickered slightly and dimmed, and there was a vibration which moved nothing, yet filled everything in the room. Then, he spoke a single word, one which Sheena did not know.
Moricro.
He breathed. The consoles went red in response, and beeps sounded as, all at once, all of Padme's vital signs began to decrease at an even more rapid pace. Her heart rate, her breathing, her blood pressure, it all flatlined in less than 5 seconds.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
Sheena screamed, her chair taking off towards Yoda, with her only being prevented from ramming into him by the sudden interception of Bucket, who grabbed her by the arm and held her up from the action. Wait, he said.
He's killing her even faster than the...
Dr. Sheena began to say. Just wait, Bucket assured her. And, against her better judgment, Sheena did, fidgeting as she watched Padme's vitals continue to decline until, at last, they all hit zero. The long, jarring beep of a flat heart rate joined the other alarms in the room as Padme Amidala and her 2 children died right before her eyes. All the while, the Jedi Master held his position over her, arms out, sweat trickling down his lined, wrinkled face. Distantly, in a different system altogether, a malicious grin formed upon another wizened face.
Good. It is done.
Hissed the insidious will of the hidden enemy of the Jedi Knights. And with that, a pall of darkness, so slight, so skillfully placed it could not have been detected, slid out from the tainted blood of Padme Amidala. This, Yoda did sense, for the enemy discarded his subtlety in those final moments, requiring it no longer, laughing into the distant darkness as his power was withdrawn. And with that, Yoda's own efforts redoubled. His eyes flashed open, his open palms tensing into claws. And dear departed Padme suddenly arched her back, bending as though subject to a powerful electric shock, and gasped, eyes opening wide. The flat beep of her heart monitor stuttered and began a more consistent ticking once more, Dr. Sheena watching with wide, unbelieving but elated eyes, as life began to return to the young senator and her unborn children. She moved back to the primary console, beginning her own work right away, even as Master Yoda breathed more and more vitality back into the soon-to-be mother. After a time, the green Jedi staggered back, making room for the medical droids which now moved forward to help deliver the distressed twins. Stumbling against the wall and leaning there, breathing heavily, he had sacrificed much just now, dangling the senator before the precipice of death and then withdrawing her by using his own life. Transferring much of what little vital essence remained within his ancient body into hers. Yet, unlike most of the sacrifices he had been made to make through the last 4 years, Yoda had a sense that this one would bear good fruit. That this time, his enemy had not foreseen or anticipated this action. And by it, perhaps his foul plans might be waylaid, or outright defied. But such things were not thoughts he could presently indulge in with any sense of certainty. So instead, he focused on the immediate victory as the sounds of new life crying out began to fill the room. And each newborn was taken into the world and named by a grateful mother whom Yoda had ensured would live for some time yet. There would be a reckoning for this, he knew. But, like his other thoughts,
Those he too pushed off for another time. Heart beating painfully in his own chest, he smiled. Even amidst so much doom and death, hope and life could spring anew in their universe, and by it, perhaps, light may yet return to the galaxy, even if for only a brief moment.
This storm isn't natural!
Boba yelled into the screaming sands, having to raise his voice to even be heard through the comms. Yannick only laughed, blinking the rushing particles out of his eyes, gritting his teeth against the airborne slurry of wind and grit. His voice was booming and nearly mocking as they continued to drive through the sudden sandstorm. They had seen it ahead of them, manifest as a huge, swirling dome of sand, with the massive wolf Lenbrek leading them straight into it. But, as large as the dome of sand was, it was minuscule when compared to the walls presented by true sandstorms, which seemed to stretch endlessly out in all directions. This, whatever it was no such monster. But Boba found that despite being smaller, it was no less powerful. He himself only barely managed to cling to the speeding bike beneath him as the winds tore at him from all sides. Sandy fingers gripping and sliding over his armor, attempting to tear him off.
I figured that much!
Yannick yelled before spitting and coughing and laughing again.
It's a witch storm! Just like the kind the spirits of Fenris could conjure. It's psychery or daemoncraft. Either way, it'll be a bloody glorious fight!
Yannick called before spitting some more.
How the hell are you still talking in all this?
Boba said, only able to manage it thanks to his enclosed armor. Yannick, predictably, laughed again.
Well, if you think this storm is even a lick compared to the blizzards of far and fair Fenris, then you've lived a soft life. But you're still young. Hope for your battles yet.
He bellowed back before coughing and hacking. Boba choked back a laugh of his own and refocused his attention. He could barely see 3 feet in front of himself. But if they were on the right track, then that meant the Tuskens would have to be stomaching all of this as well. At least, that was what he thought before they breached the inner wall of the dome. The sand was everywhere in one moment, and then settling, streaming off them into a dune of total calm the very next. For just a second, Boba thought they had actually ridden through the entire dome, given how long they had been within it as it was. But that notion was discarded quickly as enough of the sand which had caked on his visor fell away and revealed the space around them. They had been in broad daylight when entering the storm, but now they were wreathed in a hazy twilight, the dome of sand stretching up and over them, clouding even the twin stars of Tatooine. But while the borders where the wall of the storm met the sands did roil and spin, the vast space under the dome was largely calm and still, with the big exception being the speeder battle taking place at its center.
There it is!
Boba yelled, crouching, one hand gripping the seat handle while the other drew a blaster pistol.
I see it!
Yannick roared, his bike following suit as he rocketed off towards the smoking, snaking line of the spice train and the many darting forms which surrounded it. Jabba's train was clearly under duress, 3 of its 4 top-mounted blaster cannon turrets blown out and smoking. The remaining one was just barely able to fire enough volleys out to keep the attacking speeder bikes moving. The gunner was both intelligent and lucky, chasing no single target for more than a few blasts, always redirecting and firing at the speeders which were stabilizing and holding still in order to make accurate their return fire. But anyone could see that this would not last, the Tuskens most of all. To make matters worse, several speeder bikes bearing multiple riders had ridden up to the far end of the train and dispatched several raiders onto it.
They were climbing up, over, and into the train cars even now, moving through whatever defenders yet remained as they made their way towards the turret. The spice train would jerk and shake, weaving suddenly from side to side, evidently attempting to make their boarding actions more difficult. Boba looked ahead to see how close it was to the opposite wall, and squinted, realizing that the storm was moving perfectly at pace with the train, staying directly over it. So the source of it was no doubt either on board or among the attackers. And it was not long before they were among them as well. The Wolf Lord howled and his swift claws joined him, the sound loud and terrible. It was barely a second after that the speeder-mounted Tuskens, for that was indeed what they seemed to be, felt the bite of their assault. The wolf pounced upon one of the speeders, while the lord astride his back struck out and cut the front off another. Both vehicles went tumbling and burning into the sand. The two front-facing guns mounted to the front of Yannick's attack bike blazed to life, and Yannick himself drew his own weapon, the thundering bolt of technology that Boba had been trying to get closer to, and began to fire at the speeders, shredding two with explosive bolts. "Hey, careful! You have no idea which one of those bikes might have the components!" Boba yelled, but Yannick paid him no heed, howling as he tore through the sand and cruised up by the side of the train. "Are you ready, whelp?" he asked suddenly. "Ready? Ready for what?" Boba asked, trying to pick out shots of his own.
"Attaboy, whelp!"
Yannick said unhelpfully before holstering his bolter and reaching around his back, grabbing the bounty hunter by the rear of his armor.
"Karking, kark! What the hell are you—"
Boba began to yell before he was suddenly and unceremoniously pitched into the hull of the train. The impact rattled him to the bone and dazed him, but not enough for him to fail to grab the seam in the metal, though he dropped one of his blaster pistols to manage the grip. He grit his teeth and looked up at Yannick, who gave him a thumbs up and then veered away.
"Bastard!"
Boba grumbled, climbing up onto the top of the train and looking around. There were 15 or 16 speeder bikes still zipping about, each one now a target for the three space marines, but no longer unaware of it and acting to prolong their struggle. Boba guessed from the fact that he had been tossed onto the train that it was up to him to clear it of raiders, or to get himself killed so they would not have to pay him. Either way, it was an opportunity to show them what he could do, and he did not plan to waste it.
He was on the backmost train, and made his way to the first of the burnt-out turrets, climbing inside and down into the first compartment. He drew out a length of his thin, gauntlet-mounted fiber-whip cord, as he entered and was careful to remain silent. As he had suspected, they had not bothered to leave a lookout or rear guard once they had cleared this section of the train. After all, why would they need one? Cargo and spice crates were stacked about, and between them, the bodies of a couple of Tuskens and four dead spice runners. Boba crouched and moved up, passing into the second train, finding more bodies, but no immediate impediments. He heard a soft whine and whimpering coming from one of the alcoves created by the crates, and looked inside, seeing the yellow and blue eyes of some kind of animal or beast which crouched there. It growled at his approach, slinking in the shadows and backing away from him, one of its legs wounded and bleeding. Boba tried to assess if the thing would be a threat, but the sounds of fighting up ahead convinced him it likely wasn't. He glanced back at its two different colored eyes, gauging that it was likely a womp rat or something similar, and moving on, clearing the rest of the second compartment space. Then he was in the third. And now things got interesting. There were four Tuskens fighting inside the dingy, ill-lit space. Two spice runners struggled against them, one firing from around a chest-high stack of crates and the second grappling with a raider in close range. Hands locked around the gaffing stick the Tusken was attempting to cave her skull in with. The as-yet-unnoticed bounty hunter crept up on the Tusken firing from furthest back in their battle, waiting until the shooter in question released one of their familiar honking war cries. The train veered right, nearly throwing all within the space off their feet and sliding some of the unsecured crates, altering the dynamic of the cover they used. It was at that moment that the wrapped, desert-dwelling alien began to cry out for more blood, kneeling behind a new crate and getting one shot off, before Boba hooked his cord around the raider's neck and twisted about, his back against the Tuscan's as he cinched the cable tight and used his own weight to help choke the fighter quickly. Lungs having just expelled their reserves, heart racing with adrenaline, it was not long before the staggering Tuscan fell back, unconscious and likely dead. Boba picked up his rifle and sighted it down, aiming into the backs of the two remaining raiders who were using their own slug-thrower rifles. He fired his first shot into the skull of one, just as the remaining Tuscan fired at and hit the blaster-wielding Spice Runner. The Wee Kuei grunted and smacked against the wall behind himself, groaning and sliding down, leaving a red smear as he did. The Tuscan had little time to celebrate its shot, taking a blast to the back from Boba a moment later. The two who were left in the melee fight were a large raider and a smaller, pale-skinned, near-human woman. Boba tried to sight the warrior down, but found he was unable to get a clear shot before the Spice Runner lost her contest. Another hard jerk to the left tossed her back, causing her balance to fail for just long enough to leave her vulnerable to taking a haft to the forehead, which shoved her off and dazed her long enough for the raider to swing down with a heavy two-handed blow, almost splitting her skull with the sheer force of the strike. Fett pulled the trigger of his stolen rifle a second later, but was shocked when nothing happened. The Tuscan snapped around and saw him, bellowing a war cry as he began to charge. Boba pulled the trigger again and again, the gun firing nothing. It occurred to Boba that the weapon, a slug thrower, had run out of ammunition, which did not prevent him from flipping it around in his hands, grasping it by the barrel and swinging it to connect with the gaffing stick. Damn slug throwers! Boba grunted, the colliding strikes almost jerking the rifle from his hands as he backtracked. The large Tuscan pressing the attack, swinging and jabbing with the weapon in his wrapped hands. The clone bounty hunter struggled to maintain his footing, too small and weak to compete with the Tuscan in raw strength, yet not versed in this kind of fighting well enough to finesse a victory from skill alone. For now, it was all he could do to fend off the heavy blows, even as the rifle frayed and splintered in his hands, scattering its pieces and throwing Boba onto his back. He shuffled on his elbows, scrabbling backwards with his feet as he struggled to draw his remaining blaster pistol, which was promptly kicked out of his hands by the Tuscan raider looming over him. The burly, covered warrior raised his gaffing stick in triumph, grasping it with both hands as he prepared to swing down. But just before the instant of the stroke, holes and explosions ripped the train from the wall to their right. Crates full of water and spice bursting and shredding in an unexpected storm of shrapnel and exploding projectiles. The Tuscan was stunned by the attack, flinching out of his striking posture, and before it was clear if he had been properly struck by the hail of rounds, Boba slid his combat knife out of his boot, activating the vibro cell within the hilt at the same moment and throwing it. The blade snapped out end over end and buried itself deeply into the raider's chest. The stunned warrior pausing, dropping its weapon and looking down, dumbfounded at the knife handle protruding and vibrating in its chest. It reached for the blade, its knees already beginning to buckle, but before it could properly collapse, something else came through the wall the bolts had issued from. Yannick and his entire assault bike burst through the metal of the train and rammed into the Tuscan, crushing him messily against the opposite wall. Boba coughed and waved his hands, clearing sand and spice from the air, and looked up at the grinning marine.
You're more impressive than you look, whelp. There may be hope for you yet.
The Astartes declared with a laugh, leaning over from his smoking, rumbling bike to lend Fett a hand. The young bounty hunter took it and was yanked up to his feet, Yannick dismounting his thoroughly struck wheeled bike and looking towards the front of the train.
I assume the train controls are beyond, in the frontmost portion?
He asked, and Fett nodded, retrieving his blaster pistol as he did. Yeah, and I think the train is clear.
Boba began to say before a flash and a scream drew their attention to the small ladder which led up to the final functioning blaster turret. A body fell down from there, sliced clean in half. Both the bounty hunter and Astartes aimed their guns towards the entryway then and listened as someone began to descend down through it one step at a time. A Tusken emerged from the turret ladder, moving casually, almost slowly. He stepped out from it and into the center of the room, one lax ambulation at a time, seeming to almost not notice the other two. Even as they watched him carefully, guns up and trained on him. Something about the way the man moved seemed disturbingly familiar to the young Fett, and he took notice of the fact that this man wore his gaffing stick on his back and held no blaster or obvious weapon in his hands. The warrior looked around, his gaze slowly settling on the two of them. Once it did, the air seemed to still. The rushing wind, the only sound that could be heard.
"Why aren't you shooting at him?"
Boba whispered, though he himself had also held his fire, that sense of foreboding and recognition staying his hand.
"Because, whelp, look at what he's wearing,"
the Space Marine said, his voice low yet intense. Fett did so. The Tusken wore an odd bandolier on which hung several hefty pieces of machinery. The missing components, Fett realized. He was wearing them. And Boba had already seen the kind of damage Astartes bolters could do to anything they hit. Yannick himself slowly stowed his bolter weapon and drew a large monomolecular combat knife.
"So, he's a Tusken, eh?"
The Swift Claw said with a fanged grin, raising his combat knife into a fighting posture. Boba shook his head.
"No,"
he said. As if in response to that, the warrior activated his two weapons, though his body did not shift or move an inch. Twin burning, humming green blades of light emerged from the handles held in his hands, framing his masked face and Tusken tassel of long black braided hair in flickering emerald light.
"That is a Jedi," said Boba Fett.
Fate to follow free. The Nile runs red tonight. Spell it like a gods to the verdant plains. Each horizon is a new beginning. Rise and reign. Far from the fjords and the ice-cold currents, ravens soar over new frontiers. Songs and sagas of a fate determined. Shields and spears, vows of favor are the thrill of plunder. Pulled together for the clan and kin, clank of hammers and the crash of fire.